beauty, the bounty of God's creation, gather together and worship this day, that hear his word, feast upon his body and blood, rejoice in all the gifts he's given to us. Good to have my Lorelei, our son Andrew, here to preach today before he heads back to seminary tomorrow morning. So I look forward to the message given to us this day. Take a moment, if you would, do our Sunday wave. Good to see you all today, and those with us online as well. Order of service is printed out before us. We'll follow it as it leads us this day. We begin with our opening hymn, which is Creator Spirit, by whose aid, hymn number 500. Lord's blessings as we worship him this day.
We indeed deserve your punishment in this life and for it. trust in your mercy, we come to you for forgiveness. Our trust is not in ourselves, but in the merits of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Have mercy on us, O God. Grant us remission of all our sins, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, work within our hearts and lives. Lead us into ways that reflect your goodness and love.
God is gracious and merciful and hears our supplication. By the command of our Lord and as his called and ordained servants, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
But we will bless the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. Praise the Lord.
As for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill.
I will tell of the decree. The Lord said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you.
Praise the Lord, all nations, extol him, all peoples.
For great is his steadfast love toward us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
But we will bless the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. Praise the Lord. Please remain standing as we sing our hymn of praise. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated as we continue with the readings appointed for this day. For those of you here, please follow the back of your worship bulletin. The Old Testament reading for this now, the 12th Sunday after Pentecost, is from Isaiah chapter 51. Listen to me, you who pursue righteousness, you who seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you are hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who bore you. For he was but one when I called him, that I might bless him and multiply him. For the Lord comforts Zion. He comforts all her waste places and makes her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Give attention to me, my people, and give ear to me, my nation. For a law will go out from me, and I will set my justice for a light to the peoples. My righteousness draws near, my salvation has gone out, and my arms will judge the peoples. The coastlands hope for me, and for my arm they wait. Lift up your eyes to the heavens and look at the earth beneath. For the heavens vanish like smoke, the earth will wear out like a garment, and they who dwell in it will die in like manner. But my salvation will be forever, and my righteousness will never be dismayed. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from Romans chapters 11 and 12. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways! For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has ever been his counselor? Or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from him, and through him, and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, in proportion to our faith. If service, in our serving. The one who teaches, in his teaching. The one who exhorts, in his exhortation. The one who contributes, in generosity. The one who leads, with zeal. The one who does acts of mercy, with cheerfulness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you once again to stand with me, if you're able, in honor of the Lord. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 16th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now when Jesus came to the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter replied, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then he strictly charged the disciples to tell no one that he Grace, mercy, and peace be to you. From God our Father, from our Lord, and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. I don't know if you've noticed, I'm sure you have, over the past 20 or so years, advertisements have really jumped to the forefront of all types of media. You can hardly watch a 5-minute video on YouTube or sit down on the couch for more than 10 minutes without being pelted left and right by different companies asking you to remember their name when you consider such and such a product. I know one day I was driving home from church listening to the NFL games on the radio. There were two advertisements that came right after another. And I thought it was kind of funny. The first one is for Lazy Boy. Perfect for the average fan on a Sunday afternoon. Their slogan, of course, live life comfortably. A pretty good slogan for someone or for a company who wishes for people to really take a step back. Kick back and relax. After all, you've had a long week. The least we can do for you is to give you some small comfort before you dive back in on Monday morning. And now the ad right after that was for Nike. Probably the most famous slogan of all time, just do it. There was a study that went out, and out of all companies and all slogans, Nike far and away was the most remembered. And of course, just do it makes a lot of sense for what they sell. Activewear, sneakers, and running pants, and athletic tops, and all that. They want you to get going. Stop talking about going and working out tomorrow. Stop talking about, you know, when I have time, I'll start doing this. Go do it. Go do it now. And the more that I thought about these two commercials back to back, I started to think of us in our own faith lives. What kind of a Christian are you? Do you veer more towards the Lazy Boy side of things, where you like to stay comfortable? You like to not really go outside your own zone? You like to be right here. This is where I am. This is where I like to be. And if I take one step this way, that is one step too far. Or are you the Nike type of Christian, the one who says, you know, we've done a lot of talking about things that we should do, the word that we should proclaim, the people that we have been called to reach out to? Talk is talk. Let's lace up. Let's get to work. So I'll have you guys think about that for the remainder of this morning. And a lot of this has to do with our idea of being comfortable. My goodness, if you look around the world today, that is shown to be one of the biggest sells that any product can give you. It makes you feel comfortable. It makes you feel safe, secure. This chair, for example, this recliner, when you sit back and watch your favorite team lose by 30 on Sunday, at least you'll be comfortable doing it. This idea of comfort has just permeated through all aspects of life. Then when it comes to things like faith, we don't want to step outside our own bubble for many different reasons. Maybe it's thinking that, well, I'm not the person who really can spread that word well. It's not me. I'm not a good talker. I don't like getting in front of people. Maybe it's you're physically bound by space and time. I can't minister to people in such and such a place. But maybe it is more of a relational issue as well. Maybe you're not comfortable opening yourself up, speaking about your faith life to others for fear that they might, at the very least, kind of rebuff you a little bit. Or maybe they look down upon you. Maybe you start to lose that relationship because of your faith. Maybe that's why we as Christians today have such a hard time sharing our faith with others. Because we are too afraid of what the world around us might say in return. There's a reading from John chapter 15. Jesus tells his disciples, "You did not choose me, but I chose you. I appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. And these things I command you, that you will love one another." Brothers and sisters, we have been chosen for so much more
have been given so much more than we could ever imagine. You see, when a lot of people think about spreading their faith, sharing the word, they often look in and of themselves. Well, I can't do this. Well, I'm in this spot in my life right now. I can't do this and that and the other thing. But instead, Jesus says, it's not about you. I'm sorry, it's not. But I have chosen you. I have appointed you so that you should go, that you should bear fruit. There's a saying out there that God does not call the qualified, but instead qualifies the called. My friends, each and every one of us has that call to spread the love of Jesus. There's two things that he says here in John chapter 15 that we, as the body of Christ, should be doing. One, we should go. And two, bear fruit. That's what it comes down to. Those are our two missions in life. If you look back at Matthew chapter 28, what's known as the Great Commission, Jesus' command is to go, therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Just the first word right there, go. These disciples have gathered around Jesus as he's about to ascend into heaven. And the last command that Jesus gives is for them to go. This is a word that I think a lot of us as modern-day Christians, we're a little scared of. We're a little scared of actually lacing up and going, of sharing that love, that joy, that peace. I mean, this was, in fact, Jesus' last command he gave. I don't know about you, but if I knew that this would be the last time that I could speak to you, and the last time that I would impart wisdom upon you, I doubt if I was in Jesus' shoes, I would go ask him about to ascend to heaven. Friends, remember, when you do laundry, separate your whites from your darks. It's going to save you a lot of time. You're not going to get pink outfits of clothing. No. It's not this minute kind of mundane life hacks, so to speak. But instead, it is a greater call, a greater purpose that we have all been given, no matter how young, how old, or anywhere in between. And we're told to go where? Where do I go? Do I go within my family? I'm the most comfortable there. I can spread the love of Jesus within my immediate family. Some people aren't as comfortable even doing that. No, not just your family. Well, what about my church family? You know, most of them think the same way I do on a lot of issues. My church family, I feel pretty safe in. I can certainly spread the love of Jesus there. But it's not enough. You continue to zoom out, not only your immediate family, your church family, your community, your town, your city, your state, your nation, and all over the world. Friends, that is what we have been called to do. And I know that in these past few months with COVID running rampant, a lot of people have decided to focus completely on themselves. And they have cut themselves off from people left and right. And this is where I say in the year 2020, the technology we have is a wonderful way to continue to reach out. I don't know if you've noticed during this, the churches so much more are using things like live streaming online. Churches that had no clue how to deal with anything technological, they are using this as a way to reach out to people that they might not otherwise reach out to. I doubt in my lifetime I am going to go to Mongolia. It's probably not going to happen. But through the usage of this technology, the word of God can be spread so quickly over internet waves. It's a wonderful thing. 1 Chronicles chapter 16, you know, this idea of going is not simply one command that Jesus gave then and there in the Great Commission, and it's gone ever since. No, it reaches back even further in 1 Chronicles. It says, oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. And then there you see three things. And I would dare to say that we as Christians, we do pretty well on verse 2. Give thanks to the Lord. We know that every good and every perfect gift comes to us from above, that God has richly and continues to bless us so many different ways. So I think that's a pretty easy one for us to do. Call upon his name. We as Christians know that we have a special relationship with our Savior, that we can cry out to him in prayer, and it is not just us shouting into the empty void, but instead we have a God who hears us. We have a God who listens to us. We have a God who speaks back to us, a God who answers our prayers. But this last one, make known his deeds among the peoples. My friends, how well do you do that? Are you a Christian for about an hour and a half on Sunday, and then when you go out that door, you continue your life just as any other person would? Or do you truly live as someone who has been set free from the chains of sin and death? Someone who has been redeemed. Someone who has been given the greatest gift that could ever be given, life eternal in heaven. We have a responsibility, my friends, to present that love to others. The writer of Hebrews says, we present this thing called the Word of God. This Word of God is living. It's active. It is sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces to the division of soul, spirit, of joints, and of marrow. Discerns the thoughts and intentions of the heart. We have a powerful tool on our belt. And that is the Word of God. Now, this Word of God is not one that was just written 2,000 plus years ago, and for us living in the year 2020, it holds little value. But instead, we treasure it. Because the Word of God is always applicable. Then, today, tomorrow. This Word that we have is the most precious thing we could ever come in possession of. And that's why it's all the more important to give it away as well. To share it with others who may not know it. Even to share with people who do know it, but do not really understand why it applies to them today. Friends, we are told to go. We are told to stop talking about it. Stop saying, you know, after COVID's over, we'll work on our missions and whatnot. When we're all comfortable or when we're financially secure as a church or whatnot, lace up. Get to work. I know the world around us looks bleak. There is a lot around us that should give us reason to mourn. But friends, I see the opportunities out there, and so should you. The people that are hurting, that need a Savior. People who have never known Jesus, and that is what they need most in their lives right now. Go. Go to them. But that wasn't the only thing that Jesus said in John 15 was to just go, but instead to bear good fruit. And now for us today, especially as Lutherans, we kind of jump a little bit at that line. To bear good fruit. Well, we know that as good Lutherans, that our works are not what saves us. I can't do enough good stuff to get me into heaven. That's correct. But as you think of bearing good fruit, my question for you is, does God need your good works? Does God need you to go and mow Doris's lawn later today? No, God's doing just fine with or without your good works. But you know who needs you to go mow Doris's lawn this afternoon? Doris does. That's what you're supposed to do. You do these good works not to show to God that I am worthy of a spot in heaven, but to show your neighbor on your left and your right the love that was first shown to you. You know, this picture up there is of an apple tree. And the line that's used is, why does an apple tree produce apples? Not to prove to everybody that I am an apple tree and this is what I do. But instead, it produces apples so that you and I can pluck one off the tree, shine it off, and take a bite, and be satisfied with the food that we have been given. We do these good works not for ourselves, but for others. And we don't do these good works by sitting there and trying really hard. We can try, don't get me wrong. But an apple tree does not produce apples by sitting there and going, all right, here we go. Photosynthesis. Get the apple. Core. No, that's not how the apples are grown. The tree does not sit there and try its hardest and strain. But instead, it is a natural outcome. The apple tree produces apples because it's an apple tree. Just like you and me, the children of God, the brothers and sisters in Christ, we do not do good works because we strive so hard to do them, but because it is a natural outcome of us being saved. That's why the line, we love because he first loved us, is so important. We do these things not out of benefit to ourselves, but out of unconditional love for our neighbors. James chapter 1 continues. He goes, but be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. If anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away and at once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. It's easy to sit around and talk about it. That's where we as Christians often get caught up, is the sitting around and talking about it. And I'm not saying that talking about it is a bad thing in and of itself. You gotta go do it. James says, be doers of the word, not just hearers of it. Growing up, there was a line that I heard an awful lot. Maybe it was because I didn't listen particularly well as a kid. I don't know. You'll have to ask my mom back there. But she would pull me down and she would go, hey, don't just hear what I'm saying. Listen. Tune into it. Obey. She didn't say obey. Friends, you and I so often, when we come into worship together, we hear the Word of God. We hear it spoken. But I bet you that most of us, when we leave those doors, we act the same as we did when we first came in. That Word of God that had just been shared with us did really nothing to impact our lives. And we go back out and we live our 9-to-5, our 40-hour work week kind of life. Not affected whatsoever. If we do that, we are like what James says, someone who goes and studies himself in the mirror and looks and sees all details and immediately walks away and forgets what we look like. We forget what we look like when we do not truly listen, but when we hear, when we let it go in one ear and straight out the other. That's why it's important for us as brothers and sisters in Christ to tune in. Don't just hear what's being said, but listen. Listen to the Word of God. Listen to each other, to your needs, to your hurts. When one suffers, we, as the body of Christ, all suffer together. When one person rejoices, all of us rejoice together. It is that wonderful relationship that we have as this body of Christ. Continuing on, there's a passage from Galatians here. Paul writes, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not grow weary of doing good. For in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, especially to those who are of the household of faith. I don't know if you've ever felt this way. I know I have. But when you do good things for people, it seems like it never comes back around. You give. You give of yourself. You spend time with someone who needs it. You do acts of service for people who need it. You give of in and of yourself completely. What do you get in response? It's like life just metaphorically takes a baseball bat right to the side of your temple. You've done all this good. Why am I not getting any good back? And that's what Paul talks about here in Galatians. Do not grow weary of doing good. In due season, we will reap. Friends, great is our reward in heaven. And I know for some people that's not good enough. They say, I want my return on investment right now. But let me tell you, be patient. Persevere through this muck and mire of what we call planet Earth. And your reward will await you. And I think it's interesting what Paul says here at the end. You know, then as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone. Yes. But especially those who are of the household of faith. My goodness. I have heard of so many churches where the most bitter divisions, the most petty squabbles, tear people apart, tear relationships completely apart. I've heard of the color of the carpet out in the narthex has ripped congregations limb from limb. What? Are we doing what Paul says to be especially good to those of the household of faith? Friends, if we can't be good to ourselves, if I can't love you and you and you as a brother and sister of Christ, how am I going to go and spread that love, spread that joy, spread that peace to those outside? How are those people outside of the church going to look in at us? We who are supposed to be bearing this good fruit, but instead we have borne nothing but rotten. Rotten fruit. Empty of all nutrients. Look to the person to your left and to your right. They are your brother or sister in Christ. You have been saved just as they have been saved. We are all in this fight together. We are all commanded to go. We are all commanded to bear this good fruit. Now, I have to say one of the nice things about being guest preacher is that you kind of get to pick a few different things. And Ray was so wonderful to let me request a couple of different songs. So at the later service today, you're going to hear, if you show up or if you are online, you'll hear a song called Go Light Your Boat by Chris Rice, one of my all-time favorites. And the last verse there, Chris sings, we are a family whose hearts are blazing. Let's raise our candles, light up the sky. Pray to our Father in the name of Jesus. Make us a beacon in darkest times. And I think that is so on the nose for us today. Once again, brothers and sisters, I call you brothers and sisters because we are indeed a family of faith. Our hearts are blazing on fire for the Lord. Our lives have been changed for the better. When once we lived in sin and dirt and shame and guilt, now we live free, redeemed, washed clean. We have a God who went to the cross for us. We have a God who rose from the dead for us. We have a God who is coming back for us. Goodness, we've been given a lot. Our hearts are on fire for the Lord. So we take these candles that we have, that have been lit by the Holy Spirit, and what do we do with them? If you're familiar with the little kid's song, so to speak, this little light of mine, what do you do with it? Do you hide it? Do you keep it really nice and close to yourself where it's comfortable? Where you know that things are not going to go wrong if I just hold it here? No. You hold it up high. You walk to where the darkness is. You spread that light for others to see. I say it an awful lot. I did this past year over Vicarage that live a life full of faith. Live a life so enriched by the Holy Spirit. Live a life on fire that people who do not know you, the people that do not know your faith, they will look at you and go, there is something different about that person. And I want to know what it is. In the midst of all the garbage of our world, they are smiling. They are holding their heads high. They seem like they are living for someone or something other than themselves. That's what we should be doing. Hold your candle high, friends. The song we just sang here in this service, How Can I Keep From Singing, by Robert Lowry, an old Baptist hymn. The last verse there, I'm just going to focus on those last four lines. The peace of Christ makes fresh my heart, the fountain ever springing. All things are mine since I am his. How can I keep from sinning? Once again, when we look around our world today, there is a lot of reason to not be at peace. There is a lot of reason to live in fear, to live in anger, to live in anxiety about what might happen next. But instead, you and me, as the children of God, we have this peace. That's why when you hear at the end of a sermon, I know that I use it and that my dad does it, we say, the peace of Christ which surpasses all human understanding, guard our hearts and our minds. That peace. The peace which the world will never truly understand because it is far above what makes logical sense to us. That's why we can look around at everything that goes on and smile. It's why we can look around and have that peace, have that assurance that we do not live for the world around us, but we live for what is yet to come. And then those last two lines there, all things are mine since I am his. I've said it a little bit already this morning, but we have been given so much. All things are mine. And I don't mean like a 2 or 3 year old where this is mine, and this is mine, and it's not yours because it's mine, so stay away. But instead, all things have been given to us. All things are mine. Life here, life eternal, this love, this peace, this joy that we find in Jesus Christ, these are all ours because we are his. So what are you going to do about it? How can you be given all these things and still keep your song to yourself? Instead, it should swell up in you, and you would have no choice but to shout it out for people all across the world to hear. I know Jesus, and because of that, I have this and this and this that I would have never known about. All things are ours. How can we keep from singing his praises? So I ask you, friends, going back, what kind of Christian are you? Are you the lazy boy Christian? Are you really, really excited to recline, to watch other people do the work? Are you a tad lazy? Are you unwilling to step in? Are you ultimately comfortable with where you're at? Or are you going to lace up? Stop talking about it, stop thinking about it, and instead just do it. Are you going to push the boundaries of what this world tells you you can and can't do by proclaiming that love of Jesus? Are you ready to get to work? But not only what kind of Christian are you now, but what kind of Christian will you be? It's a new day, friends. It is a day for you to look in that proverbial mirror and make those changes. It is a new day for you to take the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and not only use it for this hour and a half on Sunday, but instead all the week long. To share that story, to share that good news with other people, to bear good fruit because of what has been done for you. What kind of Christian will you be? And my prayer for you, brothers and sisters, is that you will be the latter. The one who's ready to get to work for the kingdom of God. Amen?
Amen.
And now, may that peace of God, which surpasses all our human understanding, may it guard our hearts and our minds in the one true Jesus Christ. Amen.
parts of the Apostles' Creed. So today, I invite you to stand with me as we continue with our creedal statement for this day. We have begun our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us speak together the words of the Apostles' Creed regarding the third person of the Holy Trinity.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
What does this mean?
I believe that I cannot, by my own reason or strength, believe in Jesus Christ, my Lord, or come to him. But the Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, sanctified me. The same way he calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies the whole Christian church under honor, and keeps it in Jesus Christ in the one true faith. In this Christian church, he daily enters to forgive us all our sins and the sins of all believers. On the last day, he will raise me and all the dead, and give eternal life to me and all believers in Christ. This is almost certainly true.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. We pray for the church, that God's people live confidently and share joyfully the message of salvation in word and deed. And we pray for this gathering of God's holy people, that we be blessed with all grace and evidence the fruit of the Spirit in our lives. Lord, be with us and bless us.
The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control.
We pray for our families and for those who share in our Christian fellowship and join with us in worship, and for all who are a part of the household of faith. Also, we pray for those with special concerns and needs this day, those who are hospitalized or shut in, those who are grieving, the unemployed and the underemployed, the chronically ill, and all those whose needs are known and unknown to us. Heavenly Father, this day we ask your blessings upon Carl and Catherine and Ruth. Be with the family of Gary Schultz. Be with these, your people, and all those who we name before you in our hearts at this time. Lord, we pray, grant that we bring your blessings to situations of need in all places.
If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. As we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are in the household of faith.
Merciful God, we thank you for all those faithful people whose words and actions have guided us in the past, especially remembering those no longer with us on earth, who now share in your eternal presence. By the working of your Holy Spirit, direct us to walk your servant way through our lives until that day when we stand in your glorious presence in heaven.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God.
Again, I invite you to remain standing as we prepare for the service of the sacrament. We do have an offering plate in the back on your way out if you wish to use that on this day. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of all creation, for you have had mercy on us, giving your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Send us your Holy Spirit, the Spirit who brings to life the power of Jesus Christ. Bless us, your children, so that all we who partake of Christ's holy body and of his precious blood be filled with your heavenly peace and joy, so that we live in the hope of an eternity gathered around your heavenly table.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, from the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, When he gave thanks, he broke it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." The same way also took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." We pray together the prayer of our Lord has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Again, please be seated as we prepare for distribution this day. Jeremy will be on that side. We'll have you come down down the middle here. And for this row over here, these 2 days, you'll come down this row. strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith of the life everlasting. Peace be with you.
Amen.
I make you stand as you do. Grant, O Lord, that what we have received with our lips we keep with pure hearts, and that through the gift imparted to us in this present life, we hereafter receive life everlasting. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we also ask your blessings upon Elena Randall this day. Be with her and strengthen her in this her time of need. Gather us up as a household of faith around her, rejoicing in the promises given to each one of us, and the promise that you've given to her, life everlasting. We ask your blessings to keep her strong in the midst of this difficulty, so that she might continue to proclaim your wonderful name. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Please be seated as we sing our closing hymn, Holy Spirit, Ever Love. Preschool, Lord, of course, continue asking blessings upon our preschool, asking to pray for our preschool. families who may be looking for some in-person things for their children have some contact that they would look to us as well. You'll notice at the very end, we just threw in a little note about Rally Day. We are planning on having in-person Sunday school and then logos later in the month, so our confirmation as well. So keep those in our prayers as we continue to wade through all the different things that are going on in our community, in our county, and our state and nation, of course, as well. Still looking for some cookies for Calvary as they come together. And, of course, a couple of those have been around for a little while, so if you have any need or know someone of in need for food and for assistance, please let us know. We're here